Dad in the travelling community was a force to be reckoned with. Dad was a one-man army. Tyson, from going to the gym, within a month, he was the king of the gym. But they had bats and everything, and he was beating me up, and everyone was holding the doors, and then Tyson looked around, where's Shane? Because my dad was in jail. Tyson was overweight. Tyson was going to go to Brendan Ingalls. What a lot of people don't know, yeah, Tyson used to suffer with nerves, yeah, underperformed when it mattered. So Tyson learned to deal with that at the right time, and he was also told, being a straight up boxer don't sell, so you have to be what he is today. So we went to a doctor. The doctor certified him crazy, straight jacket job. He did go down, very down. Tyson's a bad champion. It rubbed him cold, and he said it was the worst feeling of my life. Never felt nothing like it.
Well, I'm here with Shane Fury. Shane, thanks for doing this. It's you're often sort of in the background. You don't do too many interviews, but this is a. The idea of this is to get a bit more in-depth, find out about you and your life. So thanks for doing this with us.
Yeah, well, you're welcome, yeah. I hope you're ready for an hour of total bonus, but we'll go for it. You've asked me and we're here. We're doing it now.
Well, we're here in Style at your place here. Now, is this actually where you grew up? Is this where you grew up as a youngster?
Yeah. Never been nowhere else from me, you know. This is us.
So where exactly were you born? Which hospital? Can you remember?
I was actually born in Blackburn Hospital. But we moved here when I was about 9 months old.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
You've got a lot of space around here. You've always had a lot of space to sort of play as a child and stuff like that.
Yeah, we're lucky, really. Very lucky. We're actually semi country, but not too far from anything. So, it's a nice place to grow up with. And it is a nice little area. So, probably the worst people in it are us. So, we're all right.
Well, actually, just driving here, it's a really nice area, isn't it?
Mm.
So it seems like you didn't come from, you know, like sometimes you hear the boxing stories where people come from the streets, etc. You actually had a nice start out in life. Would that be a fair comment?
Listen, we live in a nice place. My dad's done well by buying it and so on. The reason why we got this place is because. My dad didn't like spending money, so he saved every penny. And I think his parents, my grandmother, told him to put it in, invest in property, whatever you've got. So he's got a few bits about him and that there, but really, we lived no better than someone in a council house. Mm-hmm. That was it. We lived no better than anyone, because that's just the way it was.
He was quite thrifty with his money then, was he? He saved rather than spent on the lavish expenses, did he?
Yeah, my dad wouldn't spend a pound. He don't like spending now, you know. We just basically got by as kids. And growing up as young kids. Yeah, well, listen, it was just as a normal thing. Growing up as young kids, we never really had my dad around us. Up until 14, we were scared of my dad. My dad was a serious character. He was into other stuff. He was into this, whatever he was into. He definitely wasn't a daddy sort of a person. You know, he'd be daddy sort of person, and we'd probably be very happy when it was daddy time. But I can remember... on one hand, down how many times it was a daddy time. You know, it'd be all right for an hour or so and then he'd be gone. Listen, he had to go out and earn a few quid and do what he was doing. When I say do what he was doing, it was nothing criminal. It was just being a Manchester man, just up and down. Wasn't a nice character when he was younger and he was a man's man. So that's what it was. We had a nice place. My dad provided for a home for us and so on. And that was about it. But we was actually scared of my dad up until we got a good age. My dad would come down through the lights because they've got a big driveway. The lights would come on and all the lights in the house would be off and we'd pretend to be asleep. That sort of thing. And that's just the way it was. You can get the gist of him now. He's a man's man, isn't it? So here's what it is.
Well, going back to, let's start then from when you were growing up as youngsters. You've given us a good little insight there, but let's just for clarity, how many siblings have you got?
Listen, there's me, Huey, Tyson and John Boy, and then my dad's got, well, we've got brothers with Tommy and Roman. They've got a different mother. I've actually got a sister as well, elsewhere. Don't know her. So
you know, early memories. Did you think you feel like you know, because you're smiling a lot.
I'm smiling because my dad's listening to this interview, yeah, and he's gonna think there's a lot of yes. But yeah,
happy memories.
There's six of us, but there's Tyson, John Boy, me and Huey, obviously, as mother and father, same mother and father, and then there's Tommy and Roman, who have obviously same father, different mother, and a daughter and a sister, which I've never met, but she's about. Which is to a different woman again.
And where, age-wise, where do you fit?
I am a third oldest.
You're the third oldest.
There's John, Tyson and me. Huey, Roman and Tommy.
Yeah, yeah. So having that many siblings as you're growing up, there's always like sibling rivalries and squabbles, but that's certainly how it has been in my sort of history. But did you, when you were growing up, did you get on well with your siblings? Can you think back to times where you know you're playing out here and stuff, and you enjoy that sort of aspect of it?
Yeah. Again, listen. Growing up, we always knew of Tommy and Roman, but it wasn't friendly. You know, me mum and obviously would be whatever she'd be and so on. And I never seen Tommy till I was a big lad. Like I never seen Tommy. First time I seen Tommy was about 12, which is ridiculous, isn't it? That you've got brothers and that there, and then you don't know them up until a good age. It's a sad thing that, but it is what it is. But with the rest of us, yeah, we're very close. I don't think you get no closer. Me and Tyson's not the same age, but we was very close.
Yeah, two years different, isn't it?
Yeah, we was very, very close. I got an older brother, what we always looked up to, we'll argue three times a day if we're around each other, but we're brothers and that's it. And, you know, we're always there. So we're always there for each other. So as well as, I don't think you get much closer brothers than what we are. And then there's Huey. He's the baby. We call him the baby. So, we're very close. But me and Tyson was extra close because we were the same age. We'd go off together, we'd sleep together, we'd just growing up together, you know what I mean? John, we used to be a bit older, and he was a man child before his age. He was a man at about, he was really an adult at 13, 14, he was gone doing his thing. And then Huey was 5 years behind me, so he was the baby. So it was me and Tyson a lot of the time.
And did you know, obviously you come from a traveller background, you know, was that an ever-present sort of thing for you growing up? Did you grow up in a traditional traveller's culture?
Yeah.
So what was that like? So tell us a little bit about how that would differ then from non-travellers as youngsters.
There was no... Do you know how people say, like they make up stories about prejudiced and not being right and so on? I can talk for myself. I've never, ever experienced that. You know, as a child and so on, growing up, I've never experienced nastiness with non-travel people. So there was none of that. Mm. From out of school, we never had no other friends, barring travellers. Okay. We'd go to school. I had school friends. But out of school, there was none. There was one lad, he actually lives down the road, called Zach. And he was our friend, still is a friend now, from being, well, we knew him pretty much all our life. But then he grew up and then we started being friends from teenagers and that. More so Tyson's friend of mine, but we were, again, friends. But he was pretty much the only non-traveller friend that we had from school.
Why was that? Is it more of a cultural comfort zone? You feel more comfortable around your own people, or is it just that's how it was done back in the day? Why was that? You didn't mix too much with non-travellers.
Not that we didn't mix, or didn't want to mix with anything, but like it's you are what your parents are, and if your parents didn't take you around these, where are we going to play with non-traveller people if we don't get took to places where there's non-traveller people? Here there was about 6 kids in the full village. So there's not really, you know what I mean? So if there wasn't travellers who would go and see, years ago, when we did used to go off with my dad and my mum, we wouldn't be going to the movies, bowling and Nando's, but there wasn't such thing as Nando's. But you know what I mean? Like normal stuff. We'd always go for a visit. Or vice versa, people would be coming for a visit. Like I had an uncle, Yui. Like he wouldn't think twice about going for a visit and land at ours at 10 o'clock, and then there'd be full on chat till 3 a.m. You know what I mean? It'd just be one of them. But a visit was the job. There was no like go nice places, restaurants and that. If my mum had 100 grand, she'd spend it like the next woman would. But my dad wouldn't. Do you know what I mean? My mum did have money. The only luxuries we had in life with the modern job we got from my mother, because her parents left her a few quid and so on. So she had a few quid, but she never spent it all at once. But at the end up it was what it was. The only modern luxuries, what you'd say, like go for, I'm going to say luxuries, like go for a McDonald's, go to the pictures, go to the arcades. Well, it wouldn't be me dad what's taking you. It'd be me mum, you know what I mean? And that's the way it was. As a family, going somewhere, we would be going for a visit rather than anything else. So, and it was a handful of people who would visit. So
you're really talking here about quite a lot of social interaction. It's more like you're talking, you're really interacting with your relatives. You know, is that what you think helped make the bond so close? You know, just that having the fact that that was what your activities were, a visit and talking and actually going over stories and things.
With who?
With your relatives.
I wouldn't say I'm really close to any relatives.
Right, okay.
I've got loads of cousins, and my first cousins I've got probably for 25 boy cousins. We're all quite close, but we'll see each other when we see each other, and that's it. It's got a good relationship with them all, yeah, but like it's what it is. There's no really, you know, we live in a different generation than the older type, obviously. Like my dad'll come in here, and I'll be led in that seat watching telly. I'll just, dad's in. I'd have a sandwich with him, watch me at telly, and that's it. Quiet. And my dad's like that there. Like, my dad, he'd like to talk. My dad wants to talk. Because his generation and his people, they would talk and talk for hours about what I don't know, but just talk to have a conversation. Very entertaining when you're listening to it. But for me to be involved with that conversation, it's just, it's like, there's only so much I talk, really.
So there's a generational difference between that generation, because when you hear about stories of your dad's generation, that's what it was. It was talking, it was stories, it was singing songs, and it was doing all of that. So you're saying that you had a slightly different realization of what your culture was. It was different to his culture.
Not the culture is exactly the same, just different times. Different times. Like my dad's people, like, my dad's people, what would he do? Like, the normality would be, I don't really know. Just talk. A conversation. And there's no conversation in the modern ones. It's just like, fucking watching the telly, shush. Or, you know, it's what it is. Like, my dad will be in training camp with Tyson, and like, Tyson, right, I'm off to bed. Oh, it's 8 o'clock, you're going to bed. There's not a blade of conversation out here. You know, it's a different time, different thing.
Yeah. There's a lot of made of the old stories of bare knuckle boxing in gypsy culture, and you hear about the names Uriah Burton and Bartley Gorman and things. Did you grow up hearing these types of stories, or were you in a generation where you'd put too much emphasis on that? Did you enjoy hearing about these old stories? Did you keep in touch with that?
I heard about more. My granddad Ophie, great man, and didn't. I've only met him a couple of times as a baby, but I've heard all stories about him being a straight shooter and take no shit from anyone, and you really wouldn't have to say much for him to pull you up and go for it. And then I heard stories about Huey and Bartley and that. But the king in our life before Tyson's took it to a total different level was my dad. You know, my dad was the baddest man on the planet to us. My dad in the travelling community was a force to be reckoned with. Like he was a big man. He was a boxer with at a stage where travellers didn't box. You know, you go to a championships now, in the final, 60% of them will be travelling kids. Back when my dad was boxing, you know, men didn't box. Men didn't. It was just a public house brawl. So when you had someone like my dad, what was a 6'3", 18 stone man, what wasn't a nice man in the first place, look at him wrong, he'd slap you up the lips, no matter who you was or what size you was, how old you was, with a name. My dad had a bad name. Not a bad name as in like a bad name. My dad was just like, they knew not to mess with my dad, and that he was the king in our life. But with him being that king, he wasn't the best of father as kids. With him being that sort of man who he is or was, he wasn't the best kiddie dad for us. And it sounds pathetic, but it's what it is.
You mentioned there that he was a feared person. He had a fearsome reputation.
My dad, I tell you what, my dad was. My dad was a one man army, up and down the Manchester. He would walk into a team of men and set about more by himself. There'd be no teams of men behind him. You know, he was a lone soldier, and around here, he had a good name on him for that shite, we had a conversation a minute ago. All that shite is done with now, isn't it? It's what it is. I don't really look up to it now. Some scrogs doing what they're doing. I'm not interested in it. So he was what he was. He was a one man band, and he'd go and do what he needed to do, and so on. So yeah, I've seen him do a lot of stuff.
As a youngster growing up, though,
seeing it, being
around it, how did that influence your, you know, you developing? Did it mean that you became a bit more violent, or you like to have a scrap or settle things with straightness?
Totally the opposite.
You went the opposite way. Yeah.
Totally the opposite.
So why is that then?
I don't know. I don't know why. Why is the opposite? I think me and my brothers, I would say that. I don't know about the nicest people, but everyone's safe. Now, there's a lot of people who I can kill stone dead. I'm not a fighter. I'm not in the shape to fight and so on, but there's a lot of people who I can absolutely smash to pieces. But that don't enter my mind. And everyone's safe. And everyone, I try and be respectable and nice to everyone. I don't think I've ever insulted anyone. And if I have, I don't know if I've done it with the drinking mate. Because when you have a few drinks, you might be a bit loud and so on. But I don't, never insulted anyone. I don't, in my life. Not that I can remember. My brother Tyson never insulted no one. But John Boy, he's a bit of a loose cannon idiot sometimes. And he can be a bit funny. Huey, he's a lovely character until he gets a drink with him. When he gets a drink down him, he's a different person. But me and Tyson has never insulted anyone, never slapped anyone, never punched anyone. I've had a few fights outside, stand up, square goes, but they insulted me. I never insulted them.
Is this as you were younger? Is this a bit more recent? Was this when you were younger?
As an adult, young lad, yeah. Young man.
Yeah.
As I was younger, listen, kids got loads of fights, didn't they? But yeah, not. not quite nice people, actually. For say it myself, yeah. I look what's around now and the attitudes of everyone, yeah. Quite nice, but I try and keep myself to myself and just do what I normally do.
Well, you actually started boxing, well, you started taking up the amateur boxing down at Jim Egan's Boxing Academy, you and Tyson, you walked in there. And you did, I mean, why did you decide to do it? Was it because you were fans of boxing? Was it because you needed something to do just to get rid of your energy? Was it because you had some pressure from your community and culture to be able to hold your hands up? Why did you decide to start boxing as an amateur?
We was always like, we'd always be like punching my dad's hands. We'd always be sparring. I'd go down, I'd have cousins not too far from me. We'd be constant sparring. And it's a traveller's thing. It's a traveller's thing to fight, really, and just play at it and do what it is. So it was always there. My dad was a boxer. We used to go to the gym with my dad. We'd hit my dad's hands and so on like that. So it was always there. But then again, we had cousins, Ophie and his brothers and that there. They used to be boxing from a very young age, fours, fives. And be going to the gyms through all the life. And we never did go to the gym. Never did go to the gym with them. And I had my other uncle, Huey. He had a son called Phil. And he done a lot of boxing. He was boxing from a young age as well. We never did box. Again, at that stage when they was about, like, my dad wouldn't take to the gym. For one, I can see why he didn't take him to the gym, why he didn't take us to the gym, because we was too young to do so. You know, it's really, I think young kids, young babies going to the gym, I think it's pointless anyway. I've taken mine now because I'm doing what I'm doing with them. But really, I probably think you're the best age probably to start would be probably 15, 16. Because the time you go up, they're sick to death of it. You know, you're sick of it at 17, 18. You've done it for 10 years. You know, if you want to do anything, even as kids, you got to do it. These kids go, they train hard and they go to the gym religiously 3-4 times a week and so on. So my dad wouldn't take you to the gym, wasn't interested. He was, I'm doing other stuff. Wasn't the slightest bit interested of taking some young lads to the gym. We'd go up and down watching the boxing and that. But for him to take time out and take us to the gym, it wasn't happening. So me and Tyson at a stage we got to a stage where we was mad about boxing and we'd go and watch the boys boxing that there. And I don't know, we were quite young. Let me get this right. We'd watch like Ophie. We watched Ophie had his first fight, obviously. They all had the first fights at 11, but was in the gym a long time before that. Mm-hmm. And we watched them all going and going and going. And then there was me and Tyson there, who was always wanting to go to the gym, but there was no gyms. We didn't know there was a gym. And to go to the middle of Manchester to a gym, it may as well be in the middle of London, because how could two lads get to the gym? My mum wouldn't take us, my dad wouldn't take us. So therefore, forget about the gym. And we'd come at that. It was 12 months of boxing nuts. We'd go to the car, go to the car boots and we'd buy boxing books and videotapes and we'd buy collections. We had boxes full of boxing tapes and just ridiculous about daft boxing, really. And we'd watch from the old black and white ones to like the present, like Mike Tyson, George Foreman. And we had videotapes, Prince Nazim. I can remember like going to watch the boxing at my granny's. My granny's used to be at the. My granny lived down the road, and she used to have satellite back then. It was a satellite dish, and we could buy the boxing. My dad would buy the boxing on there. We'd watch it there. Or another regular thing was to go to my uncle Huey's in Morecambe, and we'd watch the pay per view fights there, and we'd stay up all night watching boxing and that. So we was very into boxing, but we could never really. Building it because we had no one to take us to the boxing, and the boxing, the gyms was too far to go. My dad used to go to Liverpool training. Mm. Obviously, that was too far. And me and Tyson used to be workers. Like, we'd go to work at a young age.
What did you do for jobs?
Well, it wouldn't be a full-time thing, but we'd get some tools together. It'd be daft, like, and we'd just go down the road and we'd just kids knocking on doors. And do you want you? We used to work for some next door neighbours down here. I think it was Iranian people or whatever he was. I don't know, like Arab sort of people, lovely people. He was only moved probably 10 years ago, and he used to have a big place. And every time you go to him, there'd be the last resort. Is to go to these people, yeah, because you might get a job from someone else and it might give you £15 to do something, and you'd be doing it and enjoy doing it and doing it and get £15, it'd be really good. But these would have you working all day. You wouldn't know what you was getting, and they'd probably give you £4 at the end of it, yeah. But anyway, that was a regular thing. But we'd do all sorts. We was working from a young age. Trying to do bits and bats. If it snowed, we'd go out snow shoveling, clearing the drive, salting the paths up and that. And realistically, looking back at what it was, we'd be freezing. We'd be freezing. I can remember a particular time we'd be snow shoveling. It was deep snow and so on, and we'd go out snow shoveling, and there'd be me, Tyson, and my cousin Justin. Now, Justin would always come down. And if he come visiting, he was an away child. He spent a lot of time with us, and he'd always come down with a few quid. Like, he might have 20 quid. His man might give him £20 to come down. But that's sharp go, because there's three of us, and the sharp goes. Then we'd go out working, and then we would snow shovel all day, and we'd have about £4 a piece. Honest, that it's you'd be freezing. We'd go to the chip shop and have fucking whatever we'd have. And it'd be gone. I know it sounds pathetic, and I know it's not that long ago, but that was the truth of the matter. And we used to go to work. And from that was kids. When we got to about 15, Tyson used to drive, and we'd go out collecting scrap and cutting tree, anything, to get a few quid. That's when we started earning a few quid, because you could drive, and we had the know-how how to get a few quid. So we'd earn... spending money there would be obviously not save nothing, but we could pretty much do what we wanted with the money we earned off that.
You weren't lazy people then. You were grafters. You were
we wanted to do.
But I mean, to do that, you've also got to have quite an element of, you've got to be quite streetwise. You've got to have an element of
Well, travellers are, again, they can't read, they can't write. Probably ignorant at everything else, but common sense and streetwise, they've got a lot of, for some reason.
Yeah.
Like my boys here, they know not to say something wrong in front of people. Do you know what I mean? Where some other kid, like, whatever, blabber all out, they know, for some reason, that's natural. It's a natural instinct. I can look at another traveller and don't need to talk, but you know what it's about.
And you can weigh them up, and you can weigh a situation
instantly. There's not a person I can read people easier than what I can read anything. That's bred years and years and years and years into the same people, because travellers marry travellers. For some reason or another, they all marry one another. And no matter who they marry, you can find out. If my Shane, for example, grows up and he gets a travelling woman from Scotland, well, I don't really know that girl, and I don't know the parents. But I know them, really. I know what they are, what the morals is. They've got exactly the same shit, exactly the same beliefs as what we are. And I can find, and if I don't know her parents, I'll know people cousin to him. People what's knew him all his life. People what pulled with him. My dad used to live with him, pulled in a field with him or some sort. You know what I mean? So it's very close. So when someone's good at it, good at particular something, let's say you're good at painting, an artist, and then two artists gets together and they're really good at painting and they're really good at painting, and then she finds someone else who's really good at painting, you're going to have kids what's good at painting because it's bred in them. So it must be where travellers marry into travellers, certain things become standard because we're inbred people, because it's what it is.
Do you think that this...
Baby.
Do you think that this...
I've seen him walking there. Go on.
Sorry.
Yeah, go on.
Do you think that this, streetwise, you're talking about being able to weigh someone up, do you think that actually helped you when you... Were you and Tyson when you both started boxing? Because you've already got that element of smarts, which actually does translate well into the boxing ring.
Right. Let me just nip this, me and Tyson boxing. We used to draw kits and was nuts about boxing. I mean, nuts about it. Loved it. Dreamt about boxing. And we took, I'll tell you what we done. The very first job about boxing. Let's talk about boxing. We took, got a job. Now, there was a good woman what we went to. And every time she'd give us a job, and it was a proper job. Really, not a proper job. Proper job for some kids. Well, she'd give you good money. And we took a job for 100 quid to pull ragweed out of the field. Okay? Do you know what ragweed is?
No.
Right. Well, it kills horses, supposedly. Right. And the horses are not allowed to eat it. And she had a field full of it. So she wanted us to pull out. So, yeah, 100 pound. So what happened was, me and Tyson had this job, 100 quid. Now, this is what I mean about the... Not like we're better than anyone else, because it's not the case. But we was kids. But what happened was, we give some other kids £50 to pull the ragweed out, and we didn't lift a finger. And they worked all day. Yeah. Pulled the ragweed out, bagged it up, and that was it. We got 100 quid, give them 50 of it, and we had what it was. But the kids, again, there was kids what we knew pretty much all our life. And we, from the estate down here, do love, listen, very, like friends with them now. And they said, whatever it was, I can't remember the word for word because I'd be lying what it was. But basically, they knew where there was a boxing gym in Wivenshaw, which is a mile from here. And we said, you're lying. There's no boxing gyms in Wivenshaw. There's not. He said, yeah, it's in, I think it was, might have been the Cross Acre, Royal Oak School, or wherever it was down there. It's on, what day is it on today? It's Friday. It was Friday. It was a Friday. I can remember it was a Friday, because I'll tell you why in a minute. So it's on now. It's on tonight. It's on at 6 o'clock. We'll go. Right. So we went, and we couldn't believe it. And then there was all a load of kids there, as you go into an amateur boxing club. Loads of kids, not as much now at Jimmy Egan's, because now, like, the majority of the kids what was there then, they might have been interested in boxing. They actually wanted to learn how to box. Now it's like a kiddie's play crash if you go on non-boxer days. So we went there, and the first person we seen was old Jimmy Kelly. And a lovely man, really, really, like salt of the earth, proper man. And chit-chat, give us subs, whatever it was, a pound, whatever it was. And we was outside now. The boxers would be inside. It was like this time of year, summertime, probably a bit more into summer. So the boxers was in the gym. And we was... Outside, he was a very good teacher, like a beginner, Jimmy. Like, he would teach you from the ground, you know what I mean? Like a young lad what's never done it before, to throw a jab, they don't know how to do it. So he'd have us all stand in the line and be thrown. Like, that was the first day, teach us how to box. He said, who are you? And he knew me dad. But he didn't say anything at that time. And And he had us in. Jab, right hand, when stepping and throw the 1-2 and so on. But we wasn't like beginners. It was like a beginner can't throw punches. We was hitting hands from being kids. We were sparring. So it wasn't like a total person, a normal person that's never done it before. So it was all right. And that was it. Went in the gym, punched the bag a bit and so on. And I can remember a time. The same day, so I was there, we'd run around the park, and then later on he took us in to hit the bags in there. Load of kids, the boxes. It was only a small gym. And you've seen the ring, the little ring at Steve's. Yeah. That was the only ring. And Tyson, first day in the gym, like he hit the bag and the whole gym stopped because he was a big boy. I don't even know how old he was. He might have been 13, 14. And he was in the bag, whoop, whack, wallop, and big lad. He was obviously just probably a rank novice, but bag was coming off its rails, and he was a kid, and he was obviously a bit good. He was all right. So anyway, day was over. Nothing else spoke about. It was a Friday. And we couldn't wait to go back there. That night was drawn boxing kits. And for some reason, it was always black and gold. There was a gym called Northside, mm-hmm. which was the top amateur gym at the time. Yeah. There was a lot of good lads there. And their gym colours was black and gold. Joe Pendleton. They could wear any kit they wanted, but it had to be black and gold. So, and our colours was like, for some reason, it would always be black and gold. Long shorts, tassels on them, and all that. So the weekend dragged. Because the next day it was it might have even been a bank holiday as well. And for some reason it was long. It might have been a weekend and a bank holiday, so it was on Wednesday. It was a long time. If you ask Tyson, he'll tell you the same. And we went back to the gym, and the day that we went back to the gym, we was outside, and then Steve told Tyson, no, Jimmy says, right, Tyson, you go inside, because he was already good, you know what I mean? Tyson was special from the word go, really. Like, there was lads in there. There was a fellow called Big Lewis. He was about 6 or 8. I don't know, about 17. Anyway, I think he had 8 fights, but Steve will tell you better from the top of my head. And won 7, lost 1. And he was another fellow called Matt. He was an heavyweight, but been going to the gym for years, and it was all good lads, you know what I mean? And Tyson was a young lad, and he was sparring them. Tyson, from going to the gym, within a month, he was the king of the gym. He was like, he was a man to go on the pads. He was this and he was that. Like, he was just natural talent. What was on about before? And me, I was still running around the park with Jimmy and that there. I was obviously a lot younger, probably a lot overweight because I was a fat, well, still fat now, but I was a fat kid and so on, but it was all right. And I can remember me and Tyson used to be right hand happy. We'll land right hand, we'll let it go, and it'd be right hand. And we'd do all right when it was right hand, but we'd never be able to spar right hand. It was always a one handed spar. And they were fucking this right, the left hand at the time, me and Tyson's was just like, it was not usable. And, but again, with Tyson having natural talent, within a month, it was like, it was brilliant at it, you know what I mean? Mm. And I always struggle with the left hand, I still do it now. But anyway, so that was it. So we done... talking about me, it's my podcast, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So I can remember one particular time. We are newbies. We're newbies in the gym. And Tyson was the best from the minute he walked in the gym. He knew it. Everyone else knew it. And that was it. And he'd done a lot. What was in his fight? What you see in his fights? That you're born with. Do you know that dog and that determination and that grit? Like, and when you're tired and you, because there was obviously unfit people, overweight, we were all always big and heavy. But even from a young age, Tyson had that dog in him. And he was just Tyson, wasn't he? He's the, obviously one of the greatest boxers ever to be, in my eyes. I think he's with the size and everything else he's got and what he's got, I think he's the greatest. But with me, not so much. So on this particular occasion, we're in there now. I don't know how long we've been in there. And obviously, with me being a young fella, but always big, I was 18 stone at 13. Yeah, so I was a big lump. My teacher, yeah, was 6 foot one or two, whatever she was. Big woman. And she was a big woman, Mrs. Fodder, yeah. And I was bigger than her in year six. How old was year six? 11.
Yeah, 10, 11, yeah.
Yeah. So that shows you what it is. So I can remember this particular time. There would have been this lad. So say, for an example, I was 12. Might have been a bit older, but about 12. So this lad was like probably a bit smaller, but big lad. He'd probably been like 17 or something. But man strength. Do you know what I mean? Like, man strength, like, probably be no stronger now than what he was back then. And I can remember, years ago, we never had no gloves and that. And the gym never had no grants or anything. There was old gloves that would have been in there for 15 years with the knuckles punched right out of them. And ended up sparring. So sparring normal people, like young lads and that there. And I was always big softy. If they were smaller than me, I wouldn't try and hurt them. Like, I wouldn't dream it. Well, like, even now, listen, wouldn't try and hurt them or punch them hard, whatever it was. It would just be like top glove and let me and so on. Even that, they'd probably be 12 months older than me, but I was a big man, I was big, so I never used to do it. And this particular occasion, there was one lad, like I say, he might have been 17, 18, and we were sparring, and he put the gloves on, and I seen what, and we were sparring, all excited like that there, and I seen, but looking back at it now, like, oh, he was, at the end of the day, we was travellers in the gym, and then we was on the council estate in Withinshaw. And we've just come there. We're newbies. We're not like we are now. Everyone knows us. How are we, lads? And so on and so on. We're two fat lads there. So I can remember him. He had the pair of gloves on. And he said, take them ones off. Put them ones on. And he was punched out. Bag gloves. Yeah, punched out. And I had a spare. And he gave me two black eyes. I can remember the shots hitting me. Yeah, as a kid. And he gave me two black eyes like that. And I could feel it was flooding. Hurt, really. And I didn't forget it. I didn't forget it. And he come a couple of times and that was it. But he obviously beat me up. But wouldn't have armed if he had proper gloves on. But I could feel the knuckles, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he gave me two black eyes. So I never forgot that. And I'll jump the story just to finish this bit off. And we moved gyms. And we stuck at it. And I'll go back to this in a minute, but I'll move gyms and he come in the gym when I was well comfortable of punching his head in. Yeah, and I wanted to go over and just lay on him, but I didn't. And I asked him for a spar. I said, we'll have a spar. I wasn't aggressive to him. And I asked him for a spar, and I can remember it was totally different. Do you know what I mean? I never had punched out gloves, but I punched him up. Do you know what I mean? It was one of them. So I got my own back. But that was one occasion when we first went in the gym. I got two black eyes. Yeah. Because it was what it was. I'm in the same gym. So I've got two black eyes. And then I've got a cousin. We're in the gym now. That's all I forgot about. And so on. We went back there the next day and training and so on. So that wasn't an issue. But that stuck in my head because... Yeah, punched out gloves and he gave me two black eyes as a kid. So, all forgot about. Tyson was the king of the gym. Tyson was beating everyone up. When I say beating them up, if he was too good for him, he just let me tell you, but I'm talking from a boy 14 sparring men, and he just like block and move and so on. But if he was boxers and he thought he was as good as him, he just dog him to death, yeah. And he was the king of the gym, always has and always will be. And if there was anyone to go on the pads, Tyson's on the pads, he was Steve's man, yeah. Oh, I've done that again. And I've got a cousin, Peter's boy, Peter. Yeah, and he could get into trouble anywhere. Generally, can get into trouble anywhere. And he was a bit of a wild child, yeah. I can remember when gym finished, it's about whatever time, it might be 8 o'clock. We're in Shore Estate, and we're kids. Now, we've got my little brother, Huey. So if we was, say I would have been 12, 13, he's 5 years younger than me. And he was little, he was as wide as this table. Yeah, I was probably not much better, but felt it different at the time. Anyway, gym's finished. Peter's riding a bike. He's just got a new bike. And he's come to the gym with us. And and we're walking out. There's a few of us, but we're kids. There's me, Tyson, baby brother Huey, and my cousin Justin. I think even little Joe was there, Peter's younger brother. But I'm not sure about Joe. He might have been there, might not have been. But Peter was the only one with a bike, and he was riding back, and he rode in front of us. And he thought, because Peter was, again, Uncle Peter was like a man, he'd only have to look at us. He'd have to look at me in particular, and I'd bust out crying. Do you know what I mean? Like, respected him. He was that, like...
He's got that look.
Yeah. Well, not the look like we're scared of him, but like my dad was what he was, but Peter was like never listen, whatever he was like. So I don't know. Do you know me? I'm back with me. I keep on losing where I am. Anyway, so he's riding and he's took off on the bike, and there's these big. When I say you'd probably be teenagers now, but there was a gang of them. About generally 50 of them, they had all like zooped up cars and motorbikes and crosses and like they used to. Do you know like years ago they used to do the neon lights underneath the cars and that. It was like that type. Yeah. Like to buy an old car and do it all up. And obviously they turned on us, but Peter. He was a bit of a monkey, and he said something to him, and they asked him, "Do you want beef?" The exact words for it, and obviously he was fucking a nutter, or whatever it was. So he must have said something to him, and then he's come riding back to us. He said, "We've got a fight now." Yeah, and anyway, as he's done that, they've run to us, and we've run. Yeah, there's 50 of them. We've batched. There was fucking everything. They had bats, they had crowbars, they had everything. And we was running, run in the gym. And as we was going for the door, I got caught at the door and I got beat to pieces with some bats and just fucking not right these people.
Yeah.
Because you'd want to beat some kids up. But they had bats and everything and he was beating me up. And everyone was holding the doors and then Tyson looked around, like, where's Shane? And Tyson realised I was there, so he jumped, he bashed out the doors. And then I was an heap on the floor. And then anyway, he all got his head. That was it. So that I can remember that. So we got a good hiding. I got a good hiding that day. And that was that. So that was one of the stories between that and the busted up eyes. I don't think I've got any more stories to tell you about that gym. And then that was pretty much it. As we got older, changed gyms and that, went to the different gyms, got a bit better. I was as good as anyone else. But like I said before, boxing is much more than being able to box. I was not being clever or thinking I was something special. I was as good as heavyweight young lad. Was what you got. Like I was good sparrer, I was fast, I was very similar attributes to Tyson. But at the end of, I was into other stuff. I wanted to go places. Tyson would go to the we'd be in the middle of having a really good time. Let's say for an example, like there's a traveler occasion called conventions. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there'd be travelers from all over the country. And no matter what how good of a time it was, Tyson would write, it's gym time. Say, fuck the gym, Tyson, let's just go tomorrow. No, I've got to go, I'm going. And I'd always get in the car with him. I'd say, you're an arsehole, whatever it is, and so on. But I would always go to the gym with Tyson. But when it come to my own self, if Tyson wasn't there and the gym come on, I would forget the gym. Anyway, so that was it. Not a great boxer. Done a lot of sparring up and down and so on. And a handful of amateur fights and did no good, to be fair. So it was what it was.
Well, I've got eyewitness accounts of people who say they watched you spar with Tyson and that you know, because you knew each other so well, you were actually able to, occasionally to work out his rhythm and do really well against him, which used to frustrate him at times.
Listen, Tyson could always absolutely smash my head right in. There wasn't a day or a time where it couldn't. But if it was just boxing sometimes it would be okay. It'd be sometimes I'd help him out, as in sparring, because Tyson could never get sparring. Generally, I can remember going up and down with Tyson and he couldn't get sparring. That young lad, nobody had sparring. We heard that Danny Williams, I can't remember who he was fighting, and he was training in Doncaster at the time. We drove all the way to Doncaster. Tyson had been about, might have been 16. And we walked in the gym. And we didn't know anyone in the gym, but now it's Ian Alcock. Do you know Ian Alcock?
Yes, I'd met him just the other day and had a good chat with him, yeah?
Yeah, so Ian Alcock was in the gym. And obviously Ian Alcock's knew my dad a long time and so on, but we didn't know him. Tyson come up there to spar Danny Williams, but there was no spar. He didn't want to spar and with the wrong size and so on. And just no one wanted to spar him. He sparred when he was, again, probably about 15, 16, might have been 16. I don't know if you know him or can remember him, Dennis Hobson.
Yeah.
Cruiserweight British champion.
Yeah.
Went up there a number of occasions and got the better of him. Like, it was from a British cruiserweight champion, 6'4", for a young lad coming in the gym, 16, and beating you up. It's quite good, isn't it?
Well, he was hard to match as an amateur, wasn't he? Because I remember Steve telling me a story where he had to fight Shane McPhilbin three times because they just could not get anyone to fight Tyson, and that's why he ended up having to take the famous David Price fight, because there's literally nobody else who would fight Tyson, so Tyson had to step up and fight this guy who was a very seasoned fighter in Woodenshaw.
So with that, we was very confident in that fight. We was really ultra confident. We went up to spar. He was a professional at the time. I think he had six fights. He was with him, Frank Maloney, Scott Belshaw.
Okay, yeah.
Big puncher, big strong lad. And Tyson was just doing what Tyson normally does to everyone. And he was doing well in the amateurs. I think he had a bronze in the world and done well in the amateurs and that. And, there was a lot of pressure there. And Tyson underperformed that night. And looking back on it was actually all right. He actually done all right. Price obviously won the fight quite clear, but Tyson done well. But he very much underperformed then. That night, a lot of pressure. I don't think there's been an amateur show like it since. There was coaches' fault, so I couldn't get in the building. The forum was packed and there was thousands of people there, but it's, he underperformed.
As you sort of see, you know, this emergence of, you know, your brother, you know, your closest confidant, the person that you really look up to and you've grown up with, as you've mentioned, start to turn over as a professional and people are starting to talk about him. Does your life change as well? Does your life start to change?
No, my life's never changed one bit. Because it's not me, it's me brother. You know, I go to work every day. I've never had a penny from Tyson. Tyson's got a lot of money. I still go out to work and do a normal job.
Was there any, you know, I know there's sibling rivalry, but you're seeing Tyson making loads of money, you're seeing him getting famous, you're seeing him getting, did jealousy ever creep in?
Jealous to death, yeah.
Yeah.
No, not really. No, listen, the reason why it's not, that would never enter our mind is because I know if I want absolutely anything more than what Tyson's got, I could get it off him, whatever it is. And really, money to us is nothing. You know, I live a very similar lifestyle to Tyson. Tyson's got hundreds of millions of pounds, yeah. But go and spend a bit of time with him. Not stingy at all. But don't, there's only so much. What, right, you go on yachts, we'll go on yachts. Let's go on helicopters, let's go on these big mansion and hotels, and let's do all that. Once you've done that for a week, I'm sick to death of doing it all. So what do you do then? You come back and it's normality, innit? Or just people think, because people's got a lot of money and they are what they are, they live like that constantly. You see Conor McGregor and his speed job with his flowered shirts and all that, living it up. But when he comes back to Ireland and he's in his house and he's walking the dogs across the field and so on, it's normality, isn't it? So there's not much. So there's no jealousy, nothing really. Only want the best for Tyson. Generally, and really the stage where he's at now. For me, I'd like to see him busy, because at 34 and active is no good. I want him to get the fights what he wants and get out there.
Do you remember the night where he became basically the man when he fought Klitschko? I mean, do you remember the build up to it? Because this was finally a time when actually there's someone in front of Tyson who actually people are saying is going to beat Tyson. Before that, there were some good close fights, but really, generally, he was expected to win.
No, not at all. No. The first Chisora fight, he was a 6-1 underdog. A lot of people won a lot of money that night. What else was there?
McDermott fights. He was going the first one.
He was a big favourite, wasn't he? But realistically, looking back at it now, a 7-fight novice, really, knocked over some tomato cans. Fighting a seasoned man. Probably about as solid as British class man as what's been. I'm not saying what can develop to another to the higher level, but at a British level, John McDermott was a solid British veteran, wasn't he? Mm. So looking at a man, at a young lad, 7 fights to a man, solid, seasoned man, probably daft, really. But yeah, he was a favourite going into that. And then I don't know if he was favourite or underdog going into the second fight, but done that. And what was his fight after that? Chisora was his first underdog. He was a 6-1 underdog at a particular stage.
That was actually an exciting fight. I remember the round 10 in that fight where Chisora decided he was going to try and stick it on Tyson.
Yeah.
And you found out a little bit about Tyson in that fight as well. You found out he was willing to go to places which become a feature of his career. Were you guys always confident though that he would beat anyone put in front of him?
Yeah. There was no one. No one could beat Tyson in our mind. Realistically, I don't know what it is now, but when Tyson was fighting, it was just like he'd beat anyone. There's like Klitschko, we was so confident with Klitschko. For me, it wasn't to get the win, it was how he won doing it. I wasn't actually particularly happy about his performance winning it.
In what way?
I thought he could have done a lot better, you know. There's never a thing about Tyson winning. It's about how he wins. Super. There wasn't. Well, I'll tell you what I've done in the Klitschko fight. Now, never bet on Tyson previously. Because didn't want to bet on him. Very, very superstitious people we are, yeah? So didn't want to bet on him. And it didn't enter my mind at the minute. So I went straight to the bookies. Fight was on. Odds has come out. I went to the bookies. I ripped the receipt out and everything what was in my bank, everything, I put on.
You bet the whole lot?
Well, I was gonna, yeah. And I've ripped the receipt out and I give it to the people and I had two cards. I had a savers, which I've still got the same now, what I don't know the code to. And I had spending money, what I did know the code to. But my few quid, which wasn't a lot, I put in the savers. And I never knew the code for it. So I had to transfer it. And this was of an evening time. So I was going to go. So I totally forgot that. But I was doing it. And I thought, fuck. I didn't know the code. So the next morning, that night, I walked out. Yeah, I'm going to do it. And then I thought about it. We're happy with the win. Get the devil's money. So I never... You know when you do something for money, it's never the right thing, is it? You know, there's plenty of bridges been burnt because of money. So I didn't do that. I was dead sure a lot of people did, but I've never bet on Tyson and never would do.
That particular fight, you know, there was a lot of people saying Tyson was going to get knocked out by Klitschko. Yeah. You know, they said he'd finally met someone because he was braggadocious and brash, and I loved it. But some people were starting to... So, you know, they didn't like the braggadociousness of Tyson. But actually leading up into that, the fight actually, on the night, there was all this commotion with the ring canvas. And what did the Germans take to having your old man John, your uncle Peter, you know, yourself?
I'm realistic.
A formidable
some
team.
Rookies in the job. Peter never trained to fight before Tyson. He was training Matthew Barney for 2 weeks, and then Tyson come along. And then, because my dad was in jail, Tyson was overweight. Tyson was going to go to Brendan Ingalls. And before he went to Brendan Ingalls, he come to the gym, had a week with Peter. And obviously, listen, Peter wasn't a normal man to us. He was, and if he would have said the sky is red, it would have been red, no questions asked. With all of us, you know what I mean? So he had a week there and obviously liked it. There was good training and family, people who you value, training hard. So there was no need to move. There was never a thing of, oh, I'm not going to go to Peter because it's he's not good enough, or we want to go there because it's such an thing. It was, is he training or is he, because he's a businessman, is he training or is he not training or what? My dad was in jail. So it was never a thing. So when we found out that, yeah, you're training your dice, there was no questions. It was like we knew he'd do the best he could, and Tyson was happy, you know what I mean? And that was it. Well, again, I'm totally gone with that.
When you got there, there was a big calamity because the fight was nearly pulled at the last
minute. Oh, yeah. So what our rookies are saying, weren't I?
Yeah.
So total rookies. And then realistically, the truth of the matter is, my dad's done all this commotion about if it's not done, we're going home. 99.9% of people might have thought he was, ah, fuck him. He's talking shit. They're not going to go home. But my dad didn't want Tyson to fight some killer. My dad's kid, isn't it? My dad would have been only so happy to say, right, let's go home in the change room, Tyson. And Tyson to say, come on then, Dad, let's go home. And he loved it. Yeah, because listen, it's a very nerve-wracking thing when you value someone. Yeah. But again, what they have got is... they've got a lot of life experience, and not silly men. If you're semi good at one thing, you're all right in business. If you earn your own money, and you do all right for yourself doing a particular business. You're you know a certain category through the board, really. In common sense, a lot of common sense. If you're sinking in a ring 3 inches and you've been in thousands of boxing rings, it's not right, is it? It's not fair. So I've got to change it. We never want advantages. Just a level playing field. And if there's a man to come and beat Tyson up on a level playing field, well, that's it. There's no arguments, there's no disputes, there's no saying, oh, he had an off day and so on. I might have a rematch with him, see if I can do a bit better. But I think if you get beat by a man once, you might get beat by him again. Rare occasions, it was an off night zone, but it'll never be that. If someone beats someone, that's it. So, just a level playing field. And went over there, and everyone was super confident. I know his own brothers and his father. His father was absolutely shitting himself, but his brothers, there wasn't 1% that in our mind that Tyson was going to get beat. For me, it was how he was going to win. And that was it, period. No questions, which is very odd now because looking back at Klitschko, I'm beating for 11 years, beat everyone, ruled the division. And then us coming there, like, how old is Tyson? 26, 27?
Yeah.
There and just 26. In his stride going for it. Yeah, made it happy.
What did that win mean for your family? Because I know you said that you were very confident in Tyson, but he's now the unified heavyweight champion of the world.
Mm.
That is the pinnacle. And especially when you mentioned that the traveller culture of being boxing and having your, you know, being able to box. And that must have been such a euphoric moment for you. What can you remember the actual moment yourself and how it felt?
Yeah, I walked up the stairs and I walked in this building. I walked in the arena, whatever it was, the stadium, whatever it was, and I felt proper emotional. I think I had a cry for some reason. I'm emotional walking up the stairs. So if it was me, got to that stage, and I was good enough to get to that stage, I'd have crumbled. I'd have fell to pieces. But with Tyson being what he is, he thrived off it. You can go one way or another. Tyson used to what a lot of people don't know, yeah, Tyson used to suffer with nerves, yeah, underperformed when it mattered. David Price fight, underperformed. Lots of fights, underperformed, because Tyson's been such a great person and he's the best and he's this and that, and I mean letting men try and hit him at 17 with his hands down and he's like this and no one can hit him, and I punch behind the back. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just unbelievable. And everyone's like, Tyson's been in newspapers from being 16-year-old. Do you know what I mean? Like, it was always big news, Tyson. Yeah. So when all that, and then the pressure of not performing, it's not the thing of having a fight and getting busted up and, because a punch don't hurt you. Anyone who's done boxing, a punch don't hurt you. When you're in there, it don't hurt. It's just what it is. But it's the pressure of not performing. What happens if I lose? What happens if I don't perform? So Tyson used to build up, and he used to underperform. But he learned to deal with his nerves by me dad talking to him and basically explaining that you're going to go in and do it anyway. Get and do it. You're doing it anyway. It's not like you're not going to do it. Stop thinking about and building up to something what it's not. Because I often, when you think about things, yeah, I'll be led in the bed, which is very rare, by the way, and I've not done it for 6 months, but I'll be led in the bed. I've started running. And I'll be led in the bed. And 6 o'clock, and say if I got, I get up at 7 o'clock to go and run. 5 o'clock in the morning, I'll be thinking, oh, fuck, I've got to get it up now and go to, and I'll be thinking about it. And I'll think about it. And it'll be a big mountain to get my shoes on and get out the door. But realistically, if you just get the shoes on and go out the door, you're gone. As soon as you're out the door, it's there, isn't it? You're doing it. So the more you think about something and build it up, something what it's not, the best illustration I can do is, say for an example, you've got a, you've got to have an awkward conversation with someone. Or, say for an example, they're not really much of an example, but say for an example, for some reason, you can't come today and I've told you you can come. And you're looking forward to it and so on. And I'm building up to my head, what am I going to say to this man? I'm building and building and building up, and I'm thinking, oh, I want to say that, he's going to say that, and it's going to be a big issue, and so on and so on. And it's an issue, but really, it comes to crunch, and I've been thinking about it for a week. And then I'll say, listen, my friend, it's going to be that. And you say, oh, no worries, maybe we'll catch you next time. And I think, okay, that was easy. What was all that about? So building something up in your head, you can fall to pieces. So with that, a lot of people crumble, and the good ones will thrive off it. So he learned how to deal with what it is, but he learned to deal with it at the right time. Because if he was learning to deal with it at a higher level, you'd be beat. So Tyson learned to deal with it at the right time. And he was also told, being a straight-up boxer, don't sell. So you have to be what he is today, you know. And that's not Tyson's nature by natural. It is natural now, because if you practice something for a number of years, you become that what you practice. And he is what he is now. It's become comfortable to him. It's become normal. But as a lad, he was a quiet, shy lad. A quiet, shy lad.
It was supposed to be a golden time for you all just after that win. But, you know, unfortunately, it actually descended into quite a dark time, because I think there was a sentiment that you felt, well, certainly your dad has mentioned this in previous interviews, that he felt that the media did not give Tyson credit. Did you feel a resentment towards the general media that sort of diminished this big achievement? You know, as a family, did you feel a lot of resentment towards that and the way that he was treated after that fight?
Yeah, there was also a lot of stuff going on in the background. What all ended up Tyson losing his mind. And whether it was right or wrong, what we thought was what it was. And between that, listen, you and the rest of everyone else were the people I don't value. Can say anything they want. It's just off the back. You get punched in the mouth when I see you. You know, that's it. Fuck you. I'm sorry for swearing. But it's like nothing. Really, if you don't value anyone, and that if you don't value that certain person or the people who's doing it, well, what difference does it make? So between that, what was nothing, but then other stuff was happening, and that's what sent Icelander.
More personal things.
More personal stuff. Obviously, just family stuff and whatever. But that nothing at all sent Tyson under, barring personal stuff.
Right. So it wasn't actually linked to this media backlash.
Look at the shit Tyson gets. And the thing is, you can't please everyone, can you? So it is what it is. So nothing's a big deal when it comes to people who really don't value. Well, I've been paid, so what difference does it make? Get on to the next one. Do you know what I mean? Because you can't please everyone. Why, Dillian White, good man, nice guy. But before Tyson fought him, he was avoided. No one wants to fight Dillian White. Wilder wouldn't fight him in 5 years. Tyson's running wild from him. He's this and he's that and he's so on and so on. Now he's beat him, he's a bum. He's no good. So therefore, the same people who were saying, you're running wild, this he's going to knock you out, and he's this and that, you never fought anyone like him, and so on and so on and so on, now saying, who's he? Do you know what I mean? Like, you can't win with these people, so therefore, you don't try and win with them. So, hello and goodbye. Hello, goodbye, give me the money, and tune in and watch me, because you will do next time I fight. Simple.
You mentioned that you've touched on something there. You said that the you know, as you are very close to Tyson, obviously you're there for him. You're living his personal life with him in some regards.
Yeah.
He said this before, and I think you've touched on it before yourself, that you didn't really understand what depression or a downward spiral was, because it's not common in your community to talk about it in the travelers community. as men don't talk about these sorts of things.
Realistically, yeah. In the last 10, it's in the last 10 year, who hasn't got mental issues? Half the world's got mental problems because it's become a thing, isn't it? I think it's a load of shite still. I think, listen, if you've got mental issues, you're proper mental issues, you're somewhat seriously wrong with you. But these people, oh, I've got this and I've got that. They need a good slap up the ear hole. My opinion, I think it's a load of shite. Every one man and his dog's got a mental issue at the minute. Oh, I suffer with depression. Useless cunt. That's my opinion. But it is what it is. He did go down, very down. Yeah, and none of us knew really what it was, but it's what it is.
Do you think if he'd perhaps maybe been a bit more understanding of it, he would have come out a bit quicker? Or do you think because at first you had that reaction towards it, oh, just get on with it, that sort of thing, that might have prolonged it a little bit? Do you think he got the right help at the time?
Tyson never had no help. Mm. He never had no help. Seek medical help. Police. We went to a doctor. The doctor certified him crazy. Straight jacket job. What helped Tyson was just... What helped Tyson was God. He asked him for help. You asked him, be sincere, and God will help you. Simple. And that was it. He was in a much worse state than we actually thought, but there was no doctors to give him some temazepam to make him a luge totally. Send you off your rocker. He chucked him in the bin. So it was what it was. He asked for God's help and God helped him, you know. And he asked for a way out and he done it. Listen, he had a poor couple of years, but look at the life he's got from now, from that. You know, from that there, he's made him a superstar, isn't it? And he was he was in a serious way. He was just in a serious way. And he was down. But since then, every man and his dog has got mental issues. And I think it's a load of shite. I think 98% of it. You've got people which has got serious problems, but then you've got other people who want to jump on a bandwagon with anything. There's a lot of things going on in the world today. And it is what it is. We're not going on to that, but it's... I think you just got to get on with it.
You've mentioned God a few times, and you know we were speaking before the camera started and everything as well. That's an important feature of your life, isn't it? That's that relationship with God and religion. Can you go a little bit more into that? Why is it so important to you, and has it always been like that?
Listen, I should do a lot more than what I do. Because I believe in God, and anything I do, what's not right. The first thing what pops into mind is guilt, you know, and I should do a lot more, but I don't. But I should do a lot more for God, but I don't. And that's it. That's all there is to it. I'd never deny him, no matter what company I'm in. And if I was asked to deny him, I'd say, listen, you better chop my head off now. It is what it is. I'd quite comfortably say that. I'd never deny him. So, I do believe in God. Anything bad I do, or something what's not right, you do things sometimes what you think, oh, I shouldn't have done that. And I automatically think guilt. But really, I should do a lot more. I should whatever I could do, I should do a lot more.
What things do you value now? What things do you really value at this stage of your life?
This stage of my life, absolutely nothing worldly. I'm about the only person. I have got access to do a lot of stuff. Only through one person, through Tyson. I can go anywhere and do anything. All these major boxing events, I can be there. I can get good seats and I can do anything at all. But if it's not Tyson, I'm not interested at all. I don't like boxing. I'll watch it. I like watching boxing on the settee there, watching it. I'll watch it, have a watch of it, and that's it. Have a drink of pop, a cheese sandwich, and that's it. But actually going to the events when it's nothing at all to do with me, it's a 7-hour journey to get out now, and And I've had it. Boxing's been obviously very good. It's been a big part of our lives. But the politics of it would send you off of it. You know, everyone is out for the self, and there's no problem in that. And at the start, there was a big problem with that, because we're very trustworthy people, or was very trustworthy people. At the start, it was like, right, you're going to do that, are you? Right, no worries. There was no contract, handshake. And everyone who we'd done it with, wherever the money come involved, always, not us. When I say us, it's not us, it's Tyson. Always fuck Tyson over. And that was it. But that's all right, because that's not a thing for Tyson to be, oh, he's a bad businessman, he's an idiot, whatever. Let's say me and you's mates, and we've been friends for a long time, and you're supposed to be my mate, and you say you're going to do one thing, and I trust that you're going to do that, but once you've got it, let me give you a better illustration about that. If you're my mate, you've not got one over me. If for an example, you, right, me and you are supposed to be really good friends and I trust you, and you go and do like a tricky thing, what's done me over. Well, you haven't been cleverer than me and had one over me. You've just broke the trust what I had in you. But now it's a bit different. With Frank Warren, Bob Arum and all sorts, and whoever. Now, bearing in mind, I like Frank. Really, I think Frank has been the best promoter Tyson's ever had, yeah? But Tyson's second career, we've looked at it totally different. It's been a business. Now, like I said there, if I trust you and you have one over me, that's no shame on me being, oh, I've let someone have one over me, you're cleverer than me. That's like you breaking trust and you're the piece of shit. But another thing is, if me and you's on business friendship and you have me over, then it's a handshake, then it's, oh, you had me that. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's, there's no big deal, is there? Oh, I should have looked at it. I should have, it's, all right, let me give you an illustration. You're supposed to be my mate, I buy a car off you. It's split brand new, Shane. It's really good, nice. You're my good friend, I trust you. And then you fetch it me and all the wheels are scraped and the sides took over. I've already paid you. Well, you've not had me over, I've trusted you and you was an arsehole. Mm. But then, and then selling the car to a businessman, and he says that, well, it's down to me to look, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like, so there's differences. So it is what it is. But boxing, on the second career, it's been business. But I want you to fight there. Send me the contract over, let me lawyers look at it. And there's no issues. And Frank, if you want to try and rob me, fair dues. But I'm giving a lot of money to solicitors to try and for you not to rob me. Do you know what I mean? It's a business thing. And if someone can get someone over in business, well, that's off to them. You know what I mean? There's no issue about that. As long as you know what you're playing with. Where before it was all trusting people and so on. So you never really, people never got anything over anyone. It was just broke the trust.
Would you say now then that you're more, would you say more paranoid unit, more, you're less trusting as a unit now?
Yeah. With outside interference? Listen, you can't trust anyone. Barring my brothers, my mother, my dad, and the missus. Well, I trust them people who have just said, but even the wife can't be trusted to an extent. I love my wife and I trust her to pieces, but I'm sure these men who get cheated on trust their wife as well, didn't they? But yet they get scuttled down the road in the back of a car somewhere. So there's only certain you can trust your wife. If that makes any sense in any sort of language, the people I can trust, and bearing in mind I'd die with the missus in 2 seconds flat, I'd die with Tyson's 2 seconds flat, I'd die with you, John Boy, and me dad, and so on. As a matter of fact, would I die with me dad and me mum? Probably, yeah, of course I would, yeah. Yeah, I'd die with them. I wouldn't die for none of them, because I'd be dead and they'd be alive. But there's no closer people than what we are. And I don't trust absolutely anyone barring them. And money is never an issue. If ever me and my brothers fall out, it won't be because of money or because of anything like that there, because none of us value it. None of us value money at all. Money's nice. Money is a cherry on top of everything, because really, what's money without health and friendship? It's nothing, is it? Because what good if you're the richest man in the world, but you've got no one to spend it with, or you've got no one to share it with? What's the point of me having a nice car out there? And I know this might, whoa, he's a bragging bastard. But if I've got a nice car out there, what's the point of me driving to the shop and chucking the shop in there? I want to go nice places. I want to see nice people. I want people to say, oh, he's got a nice car, he's done well. Do you know what I mean? This money is valueless. I don't value money. Listen, you fuck without it, but I'll tell you what it is. Once you've got it, if you do have a few quid, you realise that it's not important at all. Kids, I love my children, mate. I love the nieces and nephews. I love when they're all together. I don't want to change. Tyson's mad about changing. Change, let's get better, and so on and so on. Well, I'm happy being who I am. I don't want to be better than you. I don't want to be better than my brother. I might want to be better than you or the next man. Let's be better than all the rest. But I don't want to be better than my father, my mother, my brothers. Well, let's all swallow in this swallow. That's my opinion of it. If it was up to me, I'd have arranged marriages, and I'd arrange it with my own people. I don't want to change. I'm happy being who we are. But a lot of people is, do you want to change? Do you want to better yourself and so on? Which is not wrong with that, but it's just not my cup of tea. I value my own family. I like the kids being together. I like just normal stuff.
Your own traditions, customs, ways that you're used to.
Yeah. Listen, and again, we've been in lots of nice places. More places than most people can even dream about being. Lovely places, meeting superstars, but it's been no interest. And people have paid like 100 grand to be in the same place. You know what I mean? But it's like, I just want to be home. You know what I mean? Let's go home, Tyson. After Tyson's fights, it's like pool parties, fucking this and whatever else. And we're just like, there's me, Tyson, and you. He's just like, look at these idiots. And then you see everyone else because they're around Tyson. The champagne and everyone, the sunglasses. And we're looking at each other like that. Look at him. Like, do you know, we just, job's done. Let's go on. We're focused. We've done the job what we wanted to do. Let's go on.
Do you see a lot of hangers on then? Do you see a lot of hangers on around Tyson and around yourselves when the big fights are on, the big build-ups are on?
Oh, unbelievable. There's certain people, like, and there's no, like, when I say certain people, there's no particular person, but the people, like, people what's proper sensible businessmen and sensible people, like, the carry on have them out of, like, to try and get somewhere where they're not supposed to be. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just like, fucking hell, I won't do it. I can honestly say, I like certain people. Like, I like Brad Pitt. I've got a soft spot for Brad Pitt. I like Bradley Cooper. Or is it Bradley Cooper? Might not be Bradley Cooper. Emu acts in
Limitless.
Limitless, that's him.
Bradley Cooper.
Is that Brad? Not Bradley Cooper. I like Bradley Cooper, but he acts in this other fella. He acts in, he acts in 7 Times a Day. What do you call it now?
I don't know. You're watching more films than I'm watching.
Ellen!
Matthew McConaughey. There you go, she's listening.
Yeah, so I like Matthew McConaughey. I've met him.
I like him. He's from a film in Interstellar, which is my favourite film.
I'll have to watch that. But I really, really like him. I've met him. And he was really, really, like, really a nice fella. Down to earth, lovely, bubbly fella. A lovely wife and lovely kids and that there. And that was it. So moral of the story is I met him. And I've met lots of celebrities. Look through my phone, there's not one picture. If I could be sat next to Brad Pitt having lunch, there's no way I'd go to Brad Pitt and say, can I get a picture, mate? I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't want one for a start. Even though I really like him, but I just no interest of it. You understand? They won't bother people. But these people, like, just ridiculous the way how they carry on, some of them. And some of them's like well-to-do people in their own right, you know.
Does it change your opinion of people then when you see them? You see what some people will do for 5 minutes of fame or, you know, when you see that?
I take a total dislike into them. Yeah. A total dislike into them. So yeah, that was a short answer, but yeah, that's the truth. But I get Tyson's got a close thing, and everyone at the minute, everything's on a professional basis now. So it's fine. Professional basis, that's it. How much you want? Pay you back. Bad. Done. So there's no arguments. There's no like, oh, have you seen what he's done? He's broke a trust and he's out there, because that's the thing what hurts. But on a professional basis, there's nothing.
I have seen you in the ring, emotional after some of the big wins, Wilder wins in particular. The first one, which with Tyson, we know that Tyson was robbed in that fight, but I've seen you emotional at the end of the fight, emotional when Tyson won the WBC heavyweight title in the second fight.
Listen, all of it, every fight's emotional. Well, the big fights. When he fights people who's, who's favourite to beat. I like it when Tyson's absolutely up against it. And he knows it. And the world knows it. And he's underdog and everyone's writing him off. Tyson's the best. On that circle thing, what I was on about, slices. You put Tyson on that, he's very respectable, every slice. Very respectable. Elite at most, or respectable on most of them. But there's a weakness. I think Tyson is the best getter you've ever seen. There ain't no one better than getting it. When I say that, when Tyson's not a champion or he's underdog or he's not supposed to be doing what he's supposed to do, Tyson will pull out of the bag all the time. He is zoned in, done. Tyson's a bad champion. That's his weakness. That's one of the weaknesses he got. He's a bad champion. And I don't think he's a good champion at all. But he's the best getter you've ever seen. There ain't no one else like him in the world to get. But not the best champion. I don't know how to break that down. Probably not clever enough to break it down, but he's a good getter, not a good champion.
He needs to have that challenger's mentality.
Challenger. He's liable to go in a fight where he's supposed to be blown out, or blow someone out as a run out, and get put down and have a hard fight.
Like Nevin Pankic.
Like him all, every fight what he's had, what he's stunk the place out. That's when you take note. The fights where he's had hard fights, he's supposed to be just going in there. In our own head, he's supposed to be going in there and doing a job and coming out. The fights where he's been up against it and we've been trembling, he goes in there and plays with them because he's a getter. He's not one of the... He's what he is.
I want to ask you something more about yourself and your own personality, really, because you watch boxing, you watch YouTube. As I come here, you was watching an interview on YouTube and things. You must see comments, you must see social media reactions. How is that to deal with? Because your family now is a very high-profile family and you've gone from being just, you know, a kid growing up and boxing, learning how to box, messing around on the field, etc. And you're now in the spotlight, your full family's in the spotlight. How do you deal with that, the social media stuff, seeing negative comments, seeing scandals and people making up false stories and things like that?
It really makes no difference because it's coming from people who have no interest in. You know,
doesn't hurt at all.
How can anything? How? Let me tell you one thing. Yeah. And I'll put it into a thing. It's like I go and I'm lucky enough to go out to work every day. Well, not every day. 5 days a week, and go to work, earn a few quid, come home and do my job. Period. I've got my hobbies, I've got my family, happy. I've got other brothers, which is John Boy and Yui, does the same thing. Okay? I've got another brother, which is never had a black eye, and he's a multi-millionaire. Okay. Young girls love him. He's getting 5 million. He's getting another 5 million. He's getting 100 grand to turn up and open a shop. He's getting this and he's getting that and he's getting that, whatever he's got. And he's got a nice life and a nice whatever he's got. He's that, yeah? A star in his own right. Tommy, yeah? And then we've got Tyson, which hundreds of millions of pounds. The greatest, which is more than this, which is more than the money, the greatest, if he's not the greatest, yeah, he's surely up there with the greatest to be in the argument with him of all time. Yeah? The best heavyweight on the planet today. And then you're worried about some idiot on the YouTube, whatever it might be. What's just putrefied rotten. And no matter what you've done, still wouldn't be no good. Anyway, so really, are you really bothered about that? And then you've got me dad. Yeah, let's not forget about me dad. My dad's starring his right now. My dad's getting fortunes for attending a boxing match. He's getting paid an absolute truckload of money to sit ringside at a boxing match. He's getting paid to go in and eat a free course meal. Do you know what I mean? Like, how would you take anything serious what someone sitting behind the laptop says? You know? Don't bother me at all.
What do you make of Tommy's path at the minute then? Because he's going into this YouTube type of stuff. Now, you've come from a very traditional traveller's background where you've reared up boxing and hitting pads and stuff, and it's a proper fighting stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
This is YouTube stuff. This a few... A decade ago, you would have probably not had a very good view of it. But
oh no, not definitely not. Listen, if you can get a few easy quid, only a few fooled on. But I don't think Tommy will box ever again in his life. Where's he going to come down to? What sort of level is Tommy on in boxing terms? A novice. He's a novice.
Yeah, at the minute
he's had 10 amateur fights and he's a novice. So where he could be in 5 years' time, if he wanted to knuckle down and be a boxer properly, well, sky's the limit. It's down to him where he wants to do. But it's hard to be a boxer when you're already a successful made man. And there'd be more fights and so on. So really, if I was Tommy, I'm a YouTube misfit man. Simple. Let's have it. KSI or whoever else after that. Phil Mitchell from EastEnders would be a good one. Listen, it makes no difference.
Are you surprised that you're saying that, though, given your upbringing, that you would advocate the sort of misfit style thing, celebrity boxing?
No, not really. Anyone who's got a problem with it is jealous of it or can't do it because they're not in a position to do it. He's obviously only in that position because he's built himself to be in that position, which, again, wasn't totally by himself. If he wasn't Tyson's brother, he wouldn't have got Love Island. Well, he got it, and he took an opportunity and made it into where he is now. Because before Tommy become on Love Island, Tommy never had 40 pence or pound 50, whatever it was, to go on the bus. He was robbing to go on the bus. He'd get chucked off at bus stations because he'd not got paid, and he'd get the next bus. To be from there, and again, nothing ever give to him, exactly the same as us. Because my dad would give you a lot. My dad wouldn't give you 5 pence. Nothing give to him. And to be from that, what's that been? 4 years ago? How long's it been? Four.
Since he's been boxing?
Yeah.
Since Love Island? Yeah, 4 or 5 years, yeah.
So since then, to be a multi-millionaire. Result, eh?
He's done well.
So you got to admire it, innit? So to listen to some idiot on the internet, what's got no love for you or anything, it's not a big deal.
Shane, I want to just go back and talk to you. You've mentioned your old man a few times. You've talked about him being a star in his own right. You said to me in Saudi Arabia, you described him as pay-per-view.
Oh, he is, isn't
he? But you mentioned earlier that he was a fearsome character growing up. He had a reputation.
Yeah. I've seen him set about hundreds of men. Hundreds. Not hundreds, but a fair few.
Yeah. So he could really, really have a fight then. He could really have a fight.
Yeah. My dad was a rough man.
Was it usually over? Was it just about proving to be the most superior fighter? Was it a pride thing?
I've no idea what it was over. Half the time, probably not a lot. But that's the way it was. You know, probably if he walked in a place and, for an example, if he never, for an example, got the respect what he thought he deserved, he, and there was a certain person like, oh, I don't care, whatever it was, yeah, crack, ever. Do you know what I mean? It was just one of them. But it's a different world now. It's a total different world.
Can't get away with that sort of stuff anymore.
No.
Really. Yeah.
But bearing in mind, these people wasn't civilians. What? It wasn't just a normal guy in a place. There was these Manchester badasses. Crack, have that, idiot. Stand over there in front of me. Or standing stiff like at a bar. Crunch. Not civilians. And these people who used to happen, they probably used to be criminals. But again, he was a one-man band and he didn't care.
He transitioned that street bare-knuckle type of fighting into professional boxing, though. I mean, he actually did. He had a good go at that.
He had a few fights. Really? What level my dad was on? In my opinion, not a good level. But you take... he's not like this. But I'm looking at a level. I look at boxing through the highest level now because of Tyson. I judge everyone off of Tyson. And if they're not on that level, or they're not, and I can't see things, it is what it is. So I've got an eye level of good and bad. And what was my dad? Fringe world level, at British level.
He's ranked in the top 10 in Britain at one point, I think, yeah.
Well, is that a good boxer? I don't think so. I wouldn't say a top 10 man in Britain is a good boxer. But they're game enough to get in there and have a go. And my dad classed it as having a few easy quid when he was doing it. He'd get a grand, 1,500. I don't know what he'd get, but it was money for nothing to have a punch up. What he'd done in the gym 4 days a week whenever he used to go. So it wasn't a thing. And again, with my dad, there wasn't no expectations of my dad. My dad was game. There was no expectations of him. My dad could have went in there and got knocked Spark out. Well, she did do on a couple of occasions. But these people would be saying he was still up. My dad's people, oh, John's a great man. He's just been flattened. Oh, a big man. He's an animal of a man, my dad. Because... To go from where he was, to go from what his people are and what he is, to go and do a professional fight against another professional fighter, it's like, you know what I mean? But to look at it at a boxing level, he had a few fights and done what he'd done, didn't he? But he was what he was. Rough lad. When he got hit with Henry Akiwunde, come out then. I hear you. I've seen a video of it. Never did see it before in my life, but he showed bollocks. He got it, and he was frustrated, like, you've been it. You just wanted a tear. Come out, he said, let's have it. If you watch it, you'll see it. You know what I mean? He didn't fold. He was just a game man. Was he a great boxer? No. Will he say he's a great boxer? Probably so, but he's not. He wasn't. Because if he was, he would have went on and on and on. But it's so hard to be a great boxer. And without natural talent, what God's blessed you with, forget about it. Tyson was the man of the gym in a week because he had natural talent. You know? So it is what it is. If it was all about training hard and putting hours in, there'd be lots of world champions. But it's not just about that. You get so far with that, and then soon as you meet a man with a bit of natural talent, what's done similar training, what you have, you beat. So without natural talent, forget about it. I wouldn't advise boxing on anyone unless they're natural talented. So you've got to find out, you've got to see, you've got to have enough sense and not be deluded in yourself that it's too hard of a sport to be mediocre. Because it's just what it is. And especially, and I'm not hating on these people what looks at as a form of a few quid. But when these people's got other attributes to go out and get a few quid, forget about boxing. If you're not naturally talented and you're beating everyone up, you're playing with everyone, then forget about it.
Because it's a tough sport, isn't
it?
Oh,
it's a tough sport.
And you're not going to make much money unless you're really at an elite level. Is that what you're aiming
at? That's it, yeah. Listen, it is what it is. Some people have a different opinion, but my opinion is, unless you're good at it, forget about it. And if you're not naturally talented, but you're at a level, you've got to know your level. Right, I'm at that. I go in the gym and I spar above my level, and I'm no good to them. So I'll stay at that level. It is what it is. But the minute you step up, you've knocked out. Who wants that? So unless you're naturally talented, boxing's not for you.
Will part of you be sad when this journey ends?
Yeah, you know? It's going to be a big, big hole.
Mm. Have you thought about that and what you would do to fill that hole? And I know you work and everything.
There's
like
nothing
that
to fill that hole. Tyson's boxing has been our life for a long, long time. Period. Nothing's been more important. Nothing at all. And that's Tyson doing it. But we're so proud of what it is. of what it is. He's a brother, isn't he? So nothing comes close to that. You know, barring obviously our health and everything, and we're out of trouble and everything else. Barring that, nothing at all comes close to what it is. And for Tyson, Ellen, here's a drink of water. Do you want a drink? Parched. Free drinks, babe. For Tyson to do something when he's not right or underperformed because he wasn't right, Tyson showed no signs at all of declining at the moment. None at all. If anything, he's got better. Tyson, where before he was like, he'd be in the gym and he'd be super boxer, always has been an amazing boxer. But now he can sit in the pocket and hit the shots, move. Like, he's a veteran at the job. He's getting better, but he showed no signs of declining at all. Well, the minute he does, I would say to him, let's get out. But he's bigger and he's stronger, and he's probably better than what he's ever been at the moment. But it's only so long you can be like that for with inactivity. The inactivity will kill anyone, especially a 34-year-old, nearly 35. Go on, I'll cut this out.
Thank you. Yeah, we'll edit this bit. Thank you very much. Are we? Thank you very much. What time are we on? How?
Fucking 7 hours. How old?
Okay.
1 hour 40.
Oh, that's all right.
We'll go for 3 hours.
Why not? Shane, the journey can't last forever, though.
Yeah, so the minute he seems to decline, that's the time to get out. But ideally, we want... you see, it's so hard at the minute. It's so hard. Tyson can't really fight anyone. Tyson's been getting paid a lot of money. So in order to get that same money, he needs to fight certain people. Okay. These certain people are tied up to get super money. Okay. The Joshuas, the so on and so on. Now, the Usyk fight. He's got actually a bad name through this here. It's become, again, the negativity and everything else. And it's like Tyson's fault. But from our point of view, there's nothing at all what could have happened. If one man has been used to getting A, and it's a business, don't let anyone fool anyone that it's not a business. There's no, it's business and pride involved. So it's what it is. It's what it is. Now let me think what happened. Well before the, straight after the Joshua fight, Tyson, I want Tyson, yeah? Right, Tyson says, no bother, let's have it. Saudis are involved, okay? Months, so straight after the Joshua fight, it's gone from there, months and months and months. What's going on? What's going on? I don't know what's going on. The talking. Every time we talk about this, me and Tyson will argue, yeah? Anyway, so £80 million, so on and so on. That's what they're getting, £100 million, so whatever, a load of shite. Pie in the sky. But the problem is, that's the talks. So this has been going on for a long time now. So Tyson's got fed up and he said, what is going on? I need to fight. He wants to fight. So don't fight Chisora and we'll give you A much. So on. So Tyson said, okay, we'll not fight Chisora. Put £10 million in an escrow account. So if certain things don't happen,
the money's safe.
Yeah, because it's Tyson's career. Tyson's got a short window and a lifespan to earn a few quid. So if he didn't fight Chisora, look how long he would have been out the ring from Dillian White to now. So now, didn't want to do that. We'll fight in, fight Chisora, and then we can fight in, when was it? Fight Chisora, when was it now? February.
December, it was December 24th.
No, when was he supposed to be fighting Usyk?
Oh, yeah. January, February, March, April, something like that. He was meant to be fighting Usyk.
Yeah, fighting Usyk. Mm. We're fighting. He wants to fight. Put £10 million otherwise in fighter. No escrow account money. So he got on the line and he wanted to fight Joshua. Obviously, we'll see in the video. Fight Joshua, so on. Joshua totally fought. Tyson was not willing to fight Joshua, period. Okay? Not fighting Joshua because there's been talks of $100 million with Usyk. There's been... Usyk's around the corner for the Undisputed and the Saudis want to give him $100 million and there's not that much money compared to over there in the Joshua fight in Wembley. So it's not going to happen. So they got together. Tyson's been online. Joshua, make him look bad. He's bluffing you. He's trying to bluff you. Make him look bad. Tyson was 100 million% serious about wanting the fight, needing the fight. Joshua agreed to the fight. Very, very simple what it was. Because they thought he was bluffing. They thought it was a chance to make Tyson look bad. Exactly what happened in a minute, where I'll go in a minute. So Tyson, everything he agreed on, the split, the 60-40, yeah, agreed to it. He's never going to do that. He's getting whatever. 60-40, yeah, send the contract over. They shit themselves when they see the contract because it was on the toes. How do we get out of this now how do we get out of it? The time was going on and on and on. So they was going to run it into the long grass and Tyson had been out the ring. The date would have been too short to happen. So it wasn't happening. They would come up with a load of excuses. And anyway, so Tyson said, it's happening or not. Everything's agreed. So you either want it or you don't want it. So it's not happening, right? Chisora comes in his place. No worries. So anyway, fights Chisora. Talks ongoing from there. Usyk in February was he supposed to fight? Or for March? Yeah. I think it was March.
It was around then.
Somewhere around there, then. Yeah? So everything's supposed to be done. I heard Frank Warren say, yeah, it's an easy fight, it's 50-50. In what world is that 50-50?
With Usyk. Some people would say, well, he's got the belts. Apart from the WBC.
Right, okay then. These boxing fans, what don't care about anyone's business, would say that. But realistically, it don't work like that. It's not like that. The purse bids have happened now. Frank Warren bid £5 million for the fight. Come on. Tyson's been getting £5 million. Do you understand? It's just not... It's what it is.
It's different levels.
Yeah, so it's a total different level. So I phoned Tyson, what's this shit about 50-50, Tyson? No, they're just saying that, dude, because this fight was never going to happen in England at the time. It was never going to happen. It was Saudi. Saudi said, right, fight Chisora, we're going to put it in, for an example, February in Saudi. You're getting so much. But it was each man to agrees money with the Saudis. So that was all done, whatever. So, all right. Don't like it, but whatever. So anyway, the Saudis have gone on and on and on and on and on. The Saudis never offered any money at all. There was never no offers off the Saudis. There was never no... There was lots of talks, but no offers. So Tyson never asked for 100 million or 200 million, whatever shit goes about. There was no offers on the table at all from both sides. There was no offers. Like, people saying, oh, he agreed to ease money and Tyson, they offered Tyson such a thing, but he wanted such, there was no offers. So the time was getting closer and closer and closer, and then they come up with, we want to build it into a bigger fight, want to build a stadium and make it the biggest fight the world's ever seen. So that was it. Done. There was no stadiums for it. The Saudis didn't want it, basically. Or they didn't want to put the money up for such a... Whatever. They didn't want it. So therefore, Wembley. 50-50 fight. Ain't 50-50 fight. Because your purse bids has been 5 million quid, whatever it is. It's not a 50-50 fight. So, again, it's not happening. Tyson's just sat back. So on, he said that they've gone... he's come over, the whatever you call him, his promoter's come over and he wants 50-50. So Tyson said, it's obviously not happening then because I'm not giving that. So Tyson got on the thing and said 70-30. Which really, 70-30 was a bit low. It's a bit, for me, it's probably a bit low. But in business terms, probably not. But man's entitled to, for me, 60-40. But he, that, like that, for me, 70-30 is on the same level as 50-50, total rank. So, so again, it was close. The fight was getting close, and Tyson, they seen Tyson wasn't training and so on. And Tyson said, listen, he's in the shopping centre, said this message. And he said, listen, if you want the fight, 70-30, you're out to go and jog on and go and fight Daniel Dubois, whatever he said. Well, again, he'd done exactly the same mistake as what Joshua done. They thought he was bluffing because he was 6-7 weeks to the fight. Well, in the ideal world, and if everything was perfect, Tyson trains twice a day, ticks over, does 40 minutes cardio, what an old woman could do, and does a bit of boxing training, whatever he does, or his weights or so on. So he trains like that, so he keeps himself in sensible condition. Ideal world, he only trains 6 weeks anyway, and a week's rest. Sugar Hill said, we want to do 5 weeks next camp. He don't want to do 6 weeks because Tyson, the best of Tyson's left in the gym after 6 weeks. Sugar Hill says, next time we do camp, we do 5 weeks and a week training and a week rest. 6 weeks all in all. So everything was on schedule. But because he does a 6 month training camp or a 4 month, however long he does, which is unheard of, you asked all these old school fighters, they train 6 weeks, 5 weeks, done. Do you know what I mean? But anyway, because they thought he needed a 3 month camp and he'd never be ready and he's only trying to bullshit you, we'll take the 30%. But they had no intentions of taking the 30%. It was just so they'd show Tyson up to, for Tyson to back out. But again, soon as he had the contracts and he ironed all the problems out, it was on top of them. They had no intentions of taking that money. But it come on top of them and that was it. It was gone.
You mentioned there that Tyson seems to have got a bad name out of this in terms of the public perception. It does seem a little bit like the public is shifting a little bit towards, you know, obviously Tyson was the people's champ. It now looks like Usyk is getting that label of the people's champ in a way. What do you make of that? Does that upset you?
No, not at all, no.
Would you agree with the statement?
Yeah, probably. In a smaller scale, but we'll see. We'll see when it happens. But the thing is, where does he warrant 50-50? He's from a country what's at war, which is very terrible, but there's no money coming from there at all. No pay-per-views or anything like that there. It's free-to-air over there. He's a foreigner who can't sell any tickets or anything. All right, the boxing people know him as a new sick man, boxing people, but the actual normal public what has to buy into these fights don't know him. The real money, it needs a caption, like... Normal people need to buy into him. So where does he warrant the money? Where does he warrant 50-50?
We're hearing
if now, he really wanted to fight, he should have took whatever he could have got, really. If he was so confident in that there. It is what it is. But it is what it is. When it happens, if it does happen, I think Tyson will demolish him. Ring's too small. Tyson, listen. He can flick. I was more nervous of him fighting Zhang than Usyk. Zhang's a big man with a big straight left what can knock a hole in that wall. The other man's a tip-tapper. Okay, any man can punch over 14 stone, but he don't look for power. It's what it is. Good boxer and that there. But Tyson's not a clumsy man. Tyson's not slow. Might not be as quick as him, but listen, he's not slow. He will unload, and when he punches, he'll be punching combinations. And I think, personally, I think he could beat him in any style he wants. I think he could beat him standing off, leaning back. Or I think he could beat him going forward and demolishing him, dogfighting him.
How would you like him to beat him?
I'd like him to beat him, demolishing him, dogfight, to show him what a proper heavyweight does to a man what's not supposed to be at his size. Because there's weight categories for a reason. And that's the reason why Tyson's arguably a great, because he's 6 foot nine, 19 stone, parabolics as big as each one of these cabinets. And that's why, you know, 6 foot three, 15 stone, 6 foot two, 14 stone, 6 foot five, 16 stone. They're not 6 foot nine. You know, you can get a great, great smaller man, and then they move up a couple of divisions, and then they're having tussles because they've only moved up 6 pounds, sometimes 8 pounds, and so on. But because they've moved up that weight, they go from a great man what's knocking everyone out to having hard tussles.
What do you say? What do you say in response to the people who think that Usyk might beat Tyson? There's a few of them out there.
Oh, you know. 100%. Listen, and it's boxing. It's all about opinions. We might all be deluded, but we're very confident if ever it happens. Don't see anyone beating Tyson. The only way Tyson gets beat is if he gets punched on that chin once and he's out, and then he can't get up because that's a possibility. And it makes no difference. Always fought Wilder and he's this and that. All men can punch, and you've got to be hit by one shot. And you're out. And if he can't get up after 10 o'clock, 10 count, you're beat. That's the only way. He's not getting out pointed. He's not getting out fought. He's not getting out boxed. He's not getting... Forget about it. The only way it happens is one punch what beats him. And that's on the chin, down. Or he goes down and he gets back up and his legs are gone and he come in and the referee stops it. That's the only way, which can happen in boxing, can't it? But if all even, and without that taking that out, there's no one in history could beat Tyson.
How does he get on with Lennox Lewis?
Oh, listen, you're asking me who thinks Tyson's the greatest of all time. I think he beats Lennox Lewis any way he wants to beat him. Any which way. Lennox Lewis had a big pair of nuts. Game and get stuck in. Was he a better boxer than Tyson?
Well, he had a lot of amateur pedigree, Lennox Lewis. He had a serious jab, maybe the best jab of all time,
well,
potentially.
Okay. I think Tyson would have beat him fairly comfortable.
Larry Holmes?
I think Tyson would have beat more. Mm-hmm. All of them. And surely some of them, because he's 6 foot nine. And they were 6 foot three. If they would have been 6 foot nine, well, the attributes they got probably a bit different. But because he's 6 foot nine and can do what he can do, I would favour Tyson over more. But bearing in mind, in boxing, anything can happen. You can get punched on the chin once and that's it. But it is what it is.
Are we going to see the super tournament? Are we going to see the super tournament, you think, in Saudi
What's
Arabia?
That?
Wilder and Joshua. Tyson and Usyk on the same night. They're talking about it, aren't they?
Who's
talking
about
figures where you see it everywhere. And
you see everywhere. But you think who would be one of the first people to hear about it?
Yeah.
Would be Tyson, would it not? Or Tyson's people? No one has come at all. The only place I've heard is on YouTube. With some idiots who want some views. What is it? Clickbait, is it called?
Clickbait.
Well, that's what it is, isn't it? If that was going to take place, or if there was any foundations to that, surely the fighters would know before anyone else would, you know? Because without the fighters, it's not going to happen, is it?
So there's been no offers, nothing?
No approaches at all. Tyson's had zero offers from anyone at any time regarding the Usyk fight or anything else to it. There's been no offers at all.
That's probably going to be quite disappointing for a lot of fans to hear that. Hopefully something does materialize.
But who with some status, with some credibility, has mentioned this and said that's a possibility? Has anyone?
No, it's all been rumblings and rumours, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Does it frustrate you then, Shane, to see so much when you see out there and you look into social media and Twitter and everything? There's so much things that have been made up, taken out of context. Does that actually infuriate you because you're sitting there and you know the actual true picture of what goes on?
100%. I love people with credibility, and they say stuff and really they've got no idea what's gone on or so on. It is what it is.
In the meantime, then, what is the Fury unit? What's the next steps for the Fury unit?
Well, it's a bank holiday Monday.
Yeah.
Bank holiday weekend. I'm going to have 3 days of having a nice time with the family. I think Tyson's back from Australia now, or he might not be. I don't know. I've not spoken to him. Might go and see him one of the days and whatever. I don't know.
What's your ideal day then on when you've got some downtime, 3 day, what's your ideal day then?
I'm a boring man, so very little, to be fair. I like a nice barbecue, a picnic or something. I like a bit of fishing, taking the kids fishing and that. And just do normal stuff with my family. I want to say my family, not just my family, because I'm not just one, oh, my kids. When I say my family, I mean the lot, you know. Women, children, a lot. Nice to go out, nice. Without friends and family, you've got nothing. Because there's nothing any good without it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. Shane, hopes for the future, hope for your kids. I mean, what would you hope for your kids? And do you try and instill some of the things you've learned along the way, to your kids?
My two boys now are in the gym. They're boxing. They're going to the exact same gym as we used to go to. And they're coming on. They're coming on fairly fast. They were totally ranked novices the other day. And now they're standing up, they're moving their head and getting them punching correct, or trying to. And they're going on, but again, if they've not got an actual bit of ability, it's pointless crap carrying on. Really, the boxing's wide open for them because of the name and so on. But if they're no good, it's just waste time. On me, as long as I can provide for the people what I need to provide for, and be healthy and strong and out of trouble. Listen, I don't want to be in no better position than what I am now. Everything's perfect now. Mother's alive, father's alive, brothers are all healthy and strong. All the kids are perfect. We haven't really had a bad day. The worst experience of my life was when my cousin got stabbed and killed. That was the worst thing. And that was, don't really get no worse. My brother John would come to the window at 7 o'clock, or it might have been at 6 o'clock, but it was daytime. In the morning, I was fast asleep. As soon as I seen him, like, my blood run cold. And he said, it was the worst feeling of my life. Never felt nothing like it. And I never want to feel it again. And he said, Rico's been stabbed and killed. Oh. It was very, I don't want to feel it again. So that was the only thing bad what's happened in our life. And it was a dreadful feeling, but immediate family, nothing's ever happened. You know, my Uncle Huey passed away well before his time. But barring that, you know, my granny died the other day, not so long ago, however long it was, but she was 85. Really throw a party. You know, when you live to that age and you see the kids grow up and that there, it's not really a thing. You know, if I get to that age, I'll ask my kids to generally throw a party. I've got my cousin's dad's passed away. But he's watched all his kids grow up. None of them has passed away before him. He's watched all his grandkids grow up. He's got great grandkids, and he's 88 year old. So really, it's party time, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
It's a great optimistic way to look at it. Yeah.
So really, what do I want? I want to stay healthy. I could do with getting in the gym and getting a bit of weight off. I've had a bad knee, so not been doing much exercise. I could do again getting a bit of weight off. I'll never be body beautiful, and I never want to be competitive at anything, but I'd like to get down the road and go for a 4 mile jog and not kill me and just be fit. You know what I mean? Nice and healthy. Look good with a shirt on. Me and the missus have a few date nights. We go off date night and it regular. Have a nice few drinks and a nice bit of food. We go to nice places. And I like taking the kids off. And listen, as long as the boxing is about, as long as Tyson's on top of his game, I'd like to see that out. I'd like him to. He's only got one more chapter to go, and that's the Undisputed. He's won every belt in boxing from the grassroots up. So that's, as long as that goes on, we're all good. And just stay the same as I am. Happy. Generally, I'm happy. I've got my hobbies. I've got my family, and I've got everything I need. Live a good lifestyle. I've got five children. I've got one on the way. Blessed. So, anything else more than that, a man's greedy. And I've got enough money to do what I want. So I'm blessed, aren't I? I've got enough money. If I want to go out, if I want to go on a holiday, I've got enough money to do that. If I want to take a day off of work, I can do so. I can do pretty much anything I want. And I've got my health and strength and everything's good. So anything more for me is greed. And I'm not interested in it. If it can just stay like it is and everyone just be traditional, we bury me mum and dad. I know it's very morbid, but when it's time for them to go in another 25 years from now, and then we get old and watch our kids grow up and I marry my daughters off and my boys get nice wives and we go to Tyson's daughter's wedding. Do you know what I mean? Like, just traditional stuff. I don't want no more because life is the best it's ever going to be now. And I'm sensible enough to know that. A lot of people just want. I am sensible enough and I'm level-headed enough to know when things is good. And things is good at the moment and has been for a fair number of years because I've had no bad patches barring that one patch.
And on that note, they do have the Rico Burton trophy at the Jimmy Egan's Boxing Academy Awards. They still have that. And yeah,
poor Rico, listen, he knew how to have a good time. He knew how to have a good time and he was my mate. He was genuine. Well, he was my cousin, first cousin, and the same age as me. And he was on a different total level to me because he was still a young man. If not still a young man. He was still single up and down and doing. I've been gone for 10 years. 13 years been with my missus, but me and him was the best of friends. Never left each other from growing up until being about 18. From being kids. But never really done much during that time since I've been married. And so obviously seeing each other regular, but never really done much. But I know, I felt when I was with him, I had a best mate, you know what I mean? And he knew the same. So listen, it was sad.
Very, very sorry for your loss.
Yeah. Is what it is. Right, is that us?
It's been great speaking to Shane, really.
Good. 2 hours. They've got to be keen to watch this, haven't they?
They'll watch it.
Yeah. All good. I've enjoyed it. I'm in an incubator with the lights on me and all that, but it's good.
It's been a pleasure.
God bless you, my friend.
Thank you, God bless.
I got a bit emotional back every time I speak about it, but
I can understand that fully. Hey, well done. Yeah. I can fully understand that.
I've enjoyed that.
Yeah,
I tell you what it is, me and my dad's not going to speak now.
Really?
We're done.
No, because you slagged his boxing off. Hey, listen, you'll give me a call. Why are you giving me a call?
Winter, it was bitterly cold. We had to wee in a bucket. And my dad was a hard, hard man, which everybody was. Every man was. You know, don't forget, they'd all been to the war. Fill up now, you know what I mean? And I was a great electrician in the respect of, how are we going to get up there? I'll get up there. And he gave us some money, Dennis Law. And it was like, wow. And we went and got something to eat. I worked in Guyana. I built a bridge across the Demerara River. Congressman Ryan got shot dead. And they made a big poison. And 900 plus people committed suicide. And I looked down, and in one of the gutters, there was a dead body. And Sam went right, Frankie went left, and they were shooting live ammunition. But I did a little bit too much of that. And then I ended up getting a name that don't mess with Kerry. A week later, they'd found Mike Tyson. And Chris, I can talk now, Chris put a gun to his head. Police estimate he was doing 80 mile an hour. I was doing 30 mile an hour, and he hit me head on. I'm emotional now. I put my arms around him and went, Simon, they've had to cut your leg off, mate. They've had to cut your leg off. I started going to Vegas with Ricky and having a right good laugh and enjoying myself 24/7, the Mayweather and all that. I started playing. We weren't made to feel welcome. We were not made to feel welcome. That's the best way I can say it. Good. I'm satisfied. Could satisfaction and happiness be the same thing?